comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. So we thank you, Lord, oh God, that we are standing on the sure foundation of the word of God. Thank you, Lord, oh God, that in spite of circumstances, oh Lord God, because we are found rooted and grounded in your word, rooted and grounded in your love, oh Father God, we shall not be moved, we shall not be shaken, oh God. Thank you, Lord, that we have hope as an anchor of our souls, oh Father. We thank you this morning in the name of Jesus. We give you thanks and we give you praise and we give you glory and honor and we give you worship, oh Lord. Unto Jesus Christ, Him alone, O Lord, be all praise. Unto Him, O Lord God, belongs all the glory, all the power, all dominion belongs to Him, O Father. We thank you this morning in the name of Jesus. O Lord, O God, I yield myself, O Lord, to the precious Holy Spirit. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you use me this morning to share the word of God. And I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' blessed name. Thank you for change. Thank you for transition. In the name of Jesus. Oh Lord, we just praise you, we bless you, exalt you, lift up the name of Jesus. Jesus' wonderful name. All the people of God said, Amen. Hallelujah. But that's why coming to church is so important. Amen. Because this is where you refuel. Come on. Amen. You with me? I'm yet to find somebody who, when they look at their petrol gauge and they see it's on reserve, won't even bother. And on reserve, you expect to get to Durban or Johannesburg on reserve tank. You must be special stupid. Come on, somebody. You know, and so many things happen in our lives, day to day. And then come the weekend, so many much has happened at work, at home, all over. You need to refuel. You need to refuel. So you come here so that you can get refueled, get empowered for the week that is ahead. Because understand, we are on a journey. Understand that we have a destiny. Understand that you're moving towards your destiny. Understand that it is all a process. But in order for you to endure the process, you need to make progress. But in order for you to make progress, you need to refuel. You with me? Amen. So you come here to hear you on the word, so that through hearing the word, faith, your faith level can increase.
Amen.
And last week I shared with you about wealth by the word. You remember that? This morning I want to share with you about holding on to the word. Holding on to the word. It is so, so important. Holding on to the word. And I want to start the book of Hebrews chapter number 1 as my foundation. Hebrews chapter 1. Praise God. Hebrews 1. When you're there, you say amen. Thank you, Jesus. Hebrews 1. When you're there, you say amen. Are you there?
Amen.
Amen. I've got one amen. Do we have another amen?
Amen.
I've got another amen. Do we have another amen?
Amen. Amen.
I've got another amen. Do we have another amen? Are you there in Hebrews 1?
Amen.
Are we all there? Amen. I want you to read verse 3 at the top of your voice. As loud as you possibly can. 1, 2, let's go. One more time. About Jesus. As we read from verse 1, it tells us God, when sundry times spoke unto us in times past, by the prophets, as in these last days spoken unto us by the person of his Son, Jesus Christ. Now, who is Jesus? John chapter number 1, since John's Gospel chapter 1 tells us that Jesus is the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. He says here, the Word of God, being the brightness of His glory and the express image of His person, and upholding all things by the Word of His power, when He had by Himself purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high. Jesus Christ sitting on the right hand of the Majesty on high, seated on the throne. The word of God is high and lifted up. Talk to me, somebody. Hallelujah. Now, I want to draw your attention to this. The Bible says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, and underline this, and upholding all things by the word of his power. Upholding all things. In other words, the word of God has the power to uphold all things. The Word of God has the power to uphold all things. As long as you hold on to the Word of God, the Word of God will hold you up. Hallelujah. You see, the Word of God is far higher than where you're at. That's why you've got to hold on to the Word, because as you hold on to the Word of God will just lift you higher and higher and higher. Come on, talk to me. Hallelujah. So you can, if you would liken the Word of God power of the word can be likened to a balloon in a swimming pool, or a beach ball. Have you ever taken a ball? No matter, listen, not even, you can even take a tennis ball and put it in the swimming pool and try and push it down and see what happens to you. What happens to it? Bounces back up. It defies the laws of gravity. You with me? A few years ago, I think in about 2013 or so, there was a gentleman who had a lobster boat, and he would go out fishing for lobsters. That was his life. That was his life. Was fishing, and it so happened that in the middle of the sea, he tried to steer the other way, but he slipped and fell backward into the sea. And the sea, all of a sudden, the waves began to carry him away from his ship. Now, he did not have a life jacket. He began floating. In fact, he went so far from his boat, it's about 64 kilometers away from his boat. But whilst the sea was carrying him, he noticed something. He noticed that his feet were suspended higher than his head. So he then realized he doesn't have a life jacket. But he looked at his feet and he noticed he had rubber boots. So the rubber boots actually caused his feet to float. So the guy then struggled and got his boots off. And he turned them the other way so that they could be filled with air, so no water could go in. And he held them, each one, under his arms. And this guy floated for 12 hours on his boots. Then when the Coast Guard began searching, 12 hours later, they found him. Had this guy let go of his boots, what do you think would have happened? He would have sunk. In the same way, God gives us his word to keep us afloat. That, you understand, so that when the rest of the world is drowning, you don't drown along with them. You've got to hold on to the word. Because when you hold on to the word of God, you are holding on to your testimony. Jesus. You understand? Your testimony is in the word itself. That's why you've got to hold on to the word. Because when you have the word, you see through your circumstance. And there is nothing that happens in your life that is not in the word. It's all covered in the word. Tell your neighbor, it's covered in the word. Whatever you're facing, it's covered in the word. So you hold on to the word because the word is, listen, the word will endure the test. The Bible says heaven and earth will pass away, but the word of God will always be made. So even your test that you're going through, as long as you have the word, you will outlive your test. As long as you have the word of God, you will outlive the test to share your testimony. Amen. Because your testimony is in the word, so you've got to hold on to the word. Don't let go of the word. The enemy will do whatever he can to get you to let go of the word, but you don't let go. Say amen to that. Amen. Hallelujah. Now, listen, when you hold on to the unsinkable, you become unsinkable. You with me? It's like that man that was holding on to his rubber boots. He held on. What happened? He was changed. He became unsinkable. So if you can hold on to the unsinkable, you become unsinkable. Because you're holding on to something that is unstoppable. You see, when God gives you a word, it's going to come to pass. The enemy can do nothing about it. Listen, Once God gives you a word, it's already a settled matter. And the enemy knows he cannot change the results. He cannot change it. So what he tries to do, in the process of waiting, he tries to stop your progress. But you've got to hold on. Tell your neighbor, hold on. Amen. So you've got to hold on to the word of God. Don't let go of the word of God. Amen. The word of God never fails. The word of God has never failed. You read from Genesis through to Revelation. You always read God said. And then a couple of chapters, maybe a book or so, then you find, and it came to pass in accordance with the word. In accordance with the word. You understand? So God has given you a word, and I'm here to tell you this morning, it's coming to pass. You may have received a word in 1985, and you thought, no, no, 1980, listen, it's coming to pass. It may have been in the year 2000, God gave you a word, it's coming to pass. You don't let go of the word of God. Talk to me, somebody. As long as you hold on to that word, you will not drown, you will not sink, you will not stop, but you will float to your destiny. Hallelujah. We just read now, the word of God. God upholds all things by the power of his word. All things are held up. Do you know the word of God is even still controlling things beneath the earth's surface? Things that are happening beneath. You see, scientists are still discovering things beneath the earth's surface. The word of God has already established it. The word of God has already established things on the earth. I mean, you see the trees, the leaves are still green. And then as seasons change, and we find the leaves start withering and they become what color? They become brown. You see that process from green, it's like a yellow and an orange, and all of a sudden it becomes brown. But you find it year after year, for millions of years, it's always been that way. Because the word of God established it to be so. Apple trees are still bearing apples today. Banana trees are still bearing bananas today. I mean, when you go to an apple tree, you don't find an orange there. What do you think is happening? God established it so in it by his word. Sister Jason just shared in Genesis chapter 1, how in the beginning of creation, God said, let it bring forth. He spoke about this, the fruit and having seed within itself. And that word is still working today. It's still being upheld. You remember when God spoke to Abraham and he told Abraham about his descendants. He says they will be slaves in a land for 400 years. But I will not forget them. I will come through for them. And even though Israel was in waiting in Egypt, they were waiting for the fulfillment of God's words. That God will raise up one of their own to deliver them. They held on for 400 years. Now if a nation could hold on for 400 years, why can't you hold on for 5 years, 10 years, 20 years, 30 years? God will come through with what he has said concerning you. Creation is upheld by the word of God. Heaven and earth shall pass away. The word of God shall not pass away. Everything that you see, it will all pass away, but the word of God will still stand. The word of God will still remain. What God said yesterday, he's still saying today. He hasn't changed his word. Tell yourself, I serve an unchangeable God. Yes. His thoughts haven't changed towards you. Oh, Jesus. You see, man can feel one way about you today. Tomorrow, he said, I changed my mind. But not so with God. His mind, the Bible says, is mindful of you. He visits you. He's mindful of you. His mind is full of thoughts concerning you. He loves you so much. You love in spite of what, listen, in spite of what people may say, God loves you. You must embed that in your heart. God doesn't change. His mind never changes. His love for you never changes. And his word never changes. The word of God is infallible. And it's a word that is everlasting. It's an eternal word. He's given you an eternal word. An eternal promise. Meaning there's nothing that anybody can do about that promise except you and you alone. So you've got a choice. You either hold on to it or you let it go. Amen. In the book of Proverbs 19:21, the Bible tells us that there are many devices in a man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord shall stand. There are many devices in a man's heart, but the counsel of the Lord shall stand. God's counsel will stand. That's why when you need direction, or you need to make decisions in your life, go to the Word of God and see what God says. Let God's Word direct you in the affairs of your life. I just shared with you, there's nothing that happens in your life that the Word of God doesn't cover. So you go to His Word and you receive counsel from the Lord, and as you receive counsel, that counsel will stand. Say amen to that. Because brothers and sisters in Christ, man-made wisdom and man-made ideas will fail. But counsel from God will always stand, will always prevail. Say amen to that. But here's the thing. We don't just do things because the rest of the world is doing it. We don't do things because everybody else is doing it. We do it because God orders it to be so. You understand? You pray, not because everybody else is praying. You pray because God wants to speak to you. He wants you to speak to Him. We read our Bible because, listen, God orders it. If you want faith, there's no other way to get faith except the Word of God. Hallelujah. Not because everybody else is doing this, you know. They dream what they dream means you must do it too. No, you are different. You operate by another word. You operate by another power. It's called the power of the word. While others are sinking, you're not sinking. While everybody's going through the fire and burning, you're not burning. Praise God, talk to me. You have a fourth man that is with you. Talk to me. Hallelujah. Amen. And you see, here's the thing. When you go to the Word, God starts revealing things to you. And once you start operating through the revealed Word, you find things that you endeavor to do will be in accordance with that Word that God has revealed to you. And as you do that, as you know, it doesn't matter the economic or the social climate. It doesn't matter what's happening around you. As long as you continue in line with what the Word of God has revealed to you, that endeavor will stand. If God has given you a dream by His Word, if He's given you an idea by His Word, it will stand. Amen. It doesn't matter what the economy looks like, because you belong to a higher economy. Come on, talk to me, somebody. It doesn't matter. People may have told you, listen, you know, it is difficult. I remember with Kurt when he was choosing his subjects in grade 10, and Kurt opted to take physics. You know, there were those who told Kurt this. He said, you know, Kurt, physics is difficult. Physics is difficult, Kurt, leave it. Not many people pass it, not many people make it. They told him to forget about it. Do you know what happened? From that year until he finished high school last year, Kurt got more in physics than he did in maths. Are you getting what I'm may tell you it cannot be done, but the word says I can do all things in Christ who gives me strength. The word says Christ in me, my hope of glory. Christ is my hope. My hope is not in myself. My hope is in Christ. My hope is in the word. I have a living hope. I have a living hope that I'm going to make it. Come on, talk to me, somebody. The circumstances will not break me. I will break it. Talk to me, somebody. Now, the word of God is seed, and the word of God is the foundation and the root of anything that will last. Everything comes by the word of God. And that word is the foundation. And that word is the root. So it doesn't matter, as long as you have that word, it doesn't matter what happens around you. It doesn't matter what news comes your way. It doesn't really matter. You'll be still standing. You that wise man who built his house upon the rock. Whilst others are building on the sand. Come on, say this with me. Whilst others are building on the sand, I'm building on the rock. The word of God is my rock. Isaiah 40 verse 8 says, the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand forever. Amen. The grass withers. Many of us, you have lawn outside your home. You know what I'm talking about. Very soon, you just see your grass all of a sudden, it's no longer growing. It's changed another color, it's gone brown. The flowers wither. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen. And just over a week's time, you know, many will be celebrating Valentine's Day. Valentine's Day is every day. Why recognize somebody on one day and the rest of the year you... But the point I'm trying to get across is those flowers you get on Valentine's Day, they're not going to last forever. They're going to dry up. They're going to die. The Bible says the grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God shall stand. The word of our God shall stand. God's word will stand, and as long as you hold on to the word of God, you shall stand. As you start operating in the word, as you start walking in the word, what happens is you start walking in covenant with God. And you must remember that God is a covenant God. He's a covenant God. Covenant means God will have you covered. As long as you're walking in the word, and you're operating in the word, God will have you covered. He will cover you. Talk to me. Psalm 74 verse 20. Go there. Let's just read this together. Psalm 74 verse 20. Praise God. Psalm 74 verse 20. When you're there, you say amen. Psalm 74 verse 20. Amen. I'm there. Are you there? Psalm 74 verse 20. Let's read it together. One, two, go. Have respect for the covenant. For the dark places of the earth are full of the horns of cruelty. Have respect unto the covenant. For the dark places of the earth are full of the habitations of cruelty. You see, brothers and sisters in Christ, it's the covenant that keeps you shielded from all the activities of the wicked. It's the covenant that shields you. You see, God, when God told Israel to apply the blood of the Lamb upon the doorposts and the lintels of their homes, it was significant, it was signifying the covenant that God had with Israel. You see, they respected their covenant as they respected what God has said. God honored the covenant. God's covenant was that wherever he sees the blood, the destroyer will pass over. Come and talk to me. Are you here? Wherever he sees the blood, the destroyer will do what? Pass over. I'm reminded of Malachi chapter 3. God said, if you remember me, I'll remember you. Return to me, I'll return to you. And God says, I will rebuke who? The devourer. You see that? Many times people are trying to rebuke, but it's God's job to do the rebuke. Your job is to believe God and to do what God says. The rebuking is God's job. Come and talk to me, somebody. God is a covenant-keeping God. Everything is in the covenant. Your healing is in the covenant. Your breakthrough is in the covenant. Your strength is in the covenant. Your promotion is in the covenant. Your success is in the covenant. And God has you covered. Talk to me. Amen. You know, when you're in covenant with God, you may find people are trying to do you in at work, but because of the covenant. Because of the covenant. God will rebuke them. God will make a public spectacle of them. Come and talk to me, somebody. Someone may be trying to do you in with a business, whatever it is. God has you covered. You remember Abram and Sarah? You remember Abram and Sarah when they got to Egypt? And Abraham thought to himself, he said, oh, if Pharaoh sees Sarah, you know, they might kill me because my wife is so beautiful. So Abram says, she's my sister. Then what happens? Pharaoh goes, he takes Sarah to his house. You understand? Takes Sarah to his home. Brings her there under his roof. And that same night, God visits him. You see, some of them are trying to do you in, but God will give them a nighttime visitation. A nighttime visitation. Come on, talk to me. God speaks to Pharaoh and he says, Pharaoh, what have you done? Because of this, I will inflict your entire home. You with me? It doesn't matter who stole what from you. The covenant will protect you. Amen. The covenant has you covered. Hallelujah! Next week, Sunday, we're going to break fast in church with communion. Come with communion to church. Amen. Oh, Jesus, help this church. I said, come with your communion to church next week, Sunday.
Amen.
Amen. We're going to have a celebration. Hallelujah. Praise God. Covenant shields you. You see, what he says here, the dark places of the earth are full of the habitations of cruelty. In other words, there's a lot of cruel things in the earth, but it's the covenant that causes you to rise above them. Whilst there's retrenchments, the covenant has you covered. Whilst businesses are becoming liquidated, the covenant has you covered. Whilst they say, you know, there's no promotions and they're closing doors, the covenant has you covered for promotion.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's the word of God which keeps you far from all the enemy's affairs. Every everything that the enemy tries, the word of God keeps you far. Because the word of God, listen, the word of God makes you the head and not the tail. The word of God causes you to be the head and not the tail. You're far above. And as long as you're above, it means you're watching from afar off. Enjoy the view. Come on, somebody. Enjoy the view. Look and see what the Lord is doing. Remember Moses. Moses lifted up his hands. As long as he lifted up his hands, what happened? The enemy could not prevail. So you've got to hold on to the word. As you hold on to the word, you don't give the enemy place in your life. Because the enemy knows the word of God has already defeated him. Hallelujah. Listen, the enemy wants to bring you to a place where you let go of the word, because he knows once you're connected to the word of God, you are connected to God himself. You see, the word gives you a divine connection. It's a divine connection. It's a connection that is divine in itself. And once you connected to that word, the enemy knows that you overcome because of your connection. So he wants to break that connection. And you're just saying that if God be for you, who can be against you? If you connected to God, who can be against you? When a man's ways please the Lord, he causes even his enemies to be at peace with him. You see that? You're not supposed to be fighting your enemies. Love them. Pray for them. Bless them. Pastor, how do I bless them? Just bless them. Don't speak bad about them. Speak good about them. Release blessings. When you're confessing blessing and favor over your life, confess it over your enemies too. Because the Bible says, if there's a man of peace and you release a word of peace, and he's a man of peace, that peace will rest upon him. But if he's not a man of peace, what will happen? That word will return back to you. You see that? So if I'm releasing blessing and the blessing cannot settle, what happens to that blessing? You see that? Hallelujah. God's word is your guarantee. Amen. God's word is your guarantee. And it's the foundation, and it's the rock on which your life is established. Once your life is established on that word, it will never fail. Here to tell you, as long as you hold on to the word of God, you will never fail. You may try to pursue something, and you may be of the opinion that you failed, but you haven't really failed. I would rather, you know, try something and fail than not trying at all. Because when I try and I fail, I become wiser. I become smarter. I learn from it. And as long as I go to the word of God, God's word will show me. God's word will direct me. God's word will give me the ideas. Come on, somebody. I mean, look at, you've all watched that movie, that fate, what's it, Fate Like Potatoes? Do you remember that? When Angus Buchan went around telling all the farmers, listen, there was drought. He said, listen, God said we must plant potatoes. Everybody thought it's a big joke, our potato man. Nobody saw what was happening beneath the surface. You see, God gave him a word, just as God gives you a word. And very often, you don't, listen, you don't physically see the word, but the word is there in the realm of the spirit. The word is, listen, the word controls the three and the fourth dimensional world. Now you may not see it, but the word is working. It's working. And the enemy will do whatever he can to stop it. But listen, when God sends out his word, the angels of God are the messengers. They are messengers of God. And they bring that word to pass. You see, angels, when you start engaging the word, you engage angels. Remember Daniel. When the angel came to Daniel, he said, Daniel, the very first day you prayed, I was sent. Because the first day Daniel prayed, God sent a word. The angel is the messenger of that word. And that word was in the realm of the spirit. The angel was bringing that word. But there was resistance. And even as there was resistance, Daniel had held his peace. He held his peace. But in the realm of the spirit, there was a fight. The angels were fighting on his behalf. The Bible says the angels of the Lord encamp about the righteous. You have angels encamped about you. You understand? Just like, you know, we were traveling in December. It's amazing. Going to Durban and coming back. Both times we saw these VIP cars coming past. You know the cars they use for these ministers of parliament. The sirens. And they move. And when those cars are moving, everybody's giving way for this car because these guys are moving. Now I think to myself that angels are ushering us into what God has destined for us.
Amen.
You are being ushered in by angels. Angels are encamping about you. Amen. It doesn't matter what the enemy tries to do. As long as you hold on to the word of God, the angels of God are with you. They're fighting for you. They're moving through. They're making way. Where there's no way, they're making the way for you.
Amen.
Hallelujah. I mean, look at this entourage when they go. The first one in the front, he just puts on his siren and you see those lights and you move. And all of a sudden, behind him is another car that is just easy access. So I see God giving you easy access in the season. Easy access. Talk to me, somebody. So you've got to keep your gaze on the word of God. Keep your eyes on the word. As long as you do that, you will not sink. Look at Peter. For as long as Peter had his eyes fixed on Jesus, he was above the water. He was walking on the water. Peter himself, just by looking at the word, he defied the laws of gravity. By looking at the word. And it's when he took his eyes off Jesus that he began to sink. It's when you take your eyes off the word that you find you begin to sink. But it's never too late, because what did Peter do? Oh, Master, save me! And Jesus says, oh, no, I'll just leave you. Why did you go in? No, Jesus saved him. So it doesn't matter where you find yourself this morning. You can just say to him, he's a savior. He's one who saves. Jesus, save me. Hallelujah. Look at Bartimaeus. Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me. That's all you need to do. Call unto him. Amen. Praise God. Two things I want you to remember. Number one, learn to ignore the storm and keep your gaze on the word. You've got to learn this. Learn to ignore the storm. Don't give thought to the storm. Because once you give thought to the storm, you give thought, you're giving your thoughts to the one who created the storm. Understand that? The Bible says, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Draw near to God, he'll draw near to you. So you must learn to ignore the storm and keep your eyes on the word. Because, listen, all the raging, all the noise, the enemy creates that because he wants you to shift your focus. Because your focus is on where God is leading you. But the storms come. The enemy creates the storms to shift your focus. Don't shift your focus. Amen? Because he knows he can do nothing concerning the results. He cannot change the results. God said it, that settles it. But he tries in that process to stop you. He tries in that process to get you to shift your focus. So don't give thought to the storm. Ignore the storm. Ignore the noise. Because it's an attempt to get you to shift. Don't shift. You say, I'm not going anywhere. Hallelujah. Number two, remain steadfast. Remain steadfast. Unmovable. Remain steadfast and become unmovable. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. You understand? Abounding. Abounding. It means you're just increasing in what God is calling you to do. You're just increasing. Always abounding in the work of the Lord. As the Bible says, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord, for surely there is an end, and your expectations shall not be cut off. What you're expecting from God, it shall not be cut off. Hallelujah. There is an end. Somebody say, there is an end. Hallelujah, hallelujah. What is the work of God? Believing in him whom he has sent. Believing in Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Having faith in Jesus. Having faith that he's your healer. Having faith that he's your deliverer. Having faith that he's your physician and he's your teacher. He's your master. He's your Lord. He's your Savior. He's the captain of your salvation. He is your life. He's the living bread which comes from heaven. He's the good shepherd. He is everything. Always acknowledging Jesus. I mean, we're faced with a pandemic. Hello, everybody. You all know what I'm talking about. So you just keep on confessing. Jesus is my Savior. Jesus is my healer. Jesus is my deliverer. Talk to me, somebody. Jesus is my protector. Always abounding. The Bible says, surely there shall be an end, and your expectation shall not be cut off. Hallelujah. I'm here to tell you, it doesn't matter what comes your way. You will live to give the testimony. You will live to declare the goodness of the Lord.
Amen.
So it doesn't matter the noise of the enemy. Keep looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Keep holding on to his promises. Don't let go.
Amen.
There are 8 things you need to do. Number one, keep declaring his revealed word over your life. You must declare. The book of Job tells us, thou shalt decree a thing, and it shall be so. Where the word of a king, of a king is, there is power. We have been made kings and priests unto God. Number one, you've got to declare his revealed word over your life. Declare your healing. Don't wait for you to get sick first before you declare your healing. Because, listen, you service the fire extinguisher before the fire comes. You must be really clever if you wait for the fire first to come and then you decide to take the fire extinguisher to get service. Because there are many folk like that. When the fire comes, now they take the fire extinguisher and have you ever seen an unserviced fire extinguisher? When you take it, you know, a fire extinguisher has that, it's got powder that forms like a foam. As soon as you take out the pin and you press the lever and the nozzle, all of a sudden from the nozzle there's like a foam that extinguishes the fire. But if you don't service it, I've seen one with my own eyes, it's never been serviced. And you pick it up and you press that thing, you know what comes up? Small drops of powder. Psst, like that. I remember we had, we moved into a house in St. Thomas Street. And when we moved in there, there was a fire extinguisher. I remember Kurt then, he said, "Dad, there's a fire extinguisher." And he thought, "Wow, this is great." And I saw this thing, it's like, gee, this thing is kind of old. His last service like 3 years ago. So I just said, let's just see what happens. Took out the pin and pressed it, just blowing. You bake, right? You take the flour and you throw it. I just take a teaspoon of flour and you go like, that's what came out of that extinguisher. That extinguisher is so big. But if you take a teaspoon of flour, that's what came out of that big thing. So you don't wait for the fire to come. Don't wait for lack to visit. And then you start confessing abundance. You confess the word of God at all times. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is my landlord. I shall never be homeless. Talk to me. The Lord is my banker. I shall not be bankrupt. Talk to me. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. You've got to confess it before it happens. I am the healer of the Lord. Confess your healing daily. Confess your promotion daily. You see that? The Lord promotes me. The Lord promotes me. You understand? Promotion comes from the Lord my God. It doesn't come from the Lord South East. You're confessing your promotion. You don't wait for him to advertise the promotion and now you're confessing your promotion. When you confess it, the day it's advertised, you say, "Thank you, Lord Jesus, I've already confessed it. I've declared it." So you keep declaring the revealed word of God over your life. Secondly, the word you are speaking is holding you up. What you speak, life and death is in the power of the tongue. What you speak is what you're going to get. If you're speaking failure, guess what's going to happen? Going to fail. You're speaking weakness and defeat, what's going to happen? You're going to be weak. You're going to be defeated. Don't speak as a victim. Speak as a victor. Understand that? Don't speak sickness because you'll become sick. You get people that always say, "I'm so poor, I can't even pay attention." Guess what? You're going to be poor. And you'll never have attention. I'm broke as a joke. Yes, you'll be broke. You'll be a joke. Don't speak those things. Speak the word. What is the gospel? Let the poor say. Let the weak say. Let the sick say. See? You've got to say it. That's why Paul said, "I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes." There's power in the gospel. We just read in Hebrews 1, verse 3. He upholds all things by the word of his power. So the word you are sending out will either uphold you or cause you to sink. Amen. Number 3. You don't have to wonder how things will turn out for you. Just settle on what God has said. Don't wonder, how is it going to happen? When is it going to happen? Because as you wonder, you become lost in your wondering. Just settle it. God said it, that settles it. I'm not going to debate about it. I'm not even going to think, how's it going to happen? It's not my business to worry about how's it going to happen. God knows how it's going to happen. You with me? He's in charge. He's in control. Number four, God is able to keep his word and his promises concerning you. He's able. He'll keep his word and he'll keep his promise to you. Doesn't matter what comes your way, it will come to pass. Amen?
Amen.
Number five, settle it in your heart that God is not a man that he should lie, nor a son of man that he should repent. Has he not said, shall he not do it? Whatever he said, he's going to do it. You see, it's so awesome. I mean, we were singing that song, this is how I fight my battles. How do we fight our battles? With the word of God. The word of God is your sword. If you want to slay a giant in your life, you've got to use the word. This is your sword. As you're speaking the word, as you're praying the word, confessing the word, meditating on the word, studying the word, doing the word, you are slaying giants. You don't know it, but that's what you actually think. That's how you've got to give time and place for the word of God as first priority in your life. The word of God must have the first and final authority. Let me put it this way. Ask yourself always, no matter what happens, maybe someone comes to you tomorrow and says, hey, you know, things are so bad economically. Things are so bad. There's already talk of retrenchments. You know, things are bad. There's talk of salary cuts. There's talk of the one that everybody's talking about. There's going to be price hikes in electricity. Electricity, the price is going to go up. Rates and taxes are going up. Inflation is going up. You say, well, speak for yourself. Let's see what God says about me. Thank you for what you're saying, but let's see what God is saying. You understand? Let's see what God says. Because this is how you fight your battles. I don't want to hear what you have to say. I want to hear what God says. You see, when you start doing that, those are great steps of faith. When you get to a place and you say, I want to see what God says about it. I mean, God is a God who multiplied fish, he multiplied loaves, he multiplied, man, talk to me, somebody, he multiplied oil, he multiplied flour. Oh, praise God, I'm growing faster than inflation. That's what it says here. You understand that? You got to talk like that. You got to have that mentality. I'm growing faster than inflation. I mean, many of you, when you take an investment, Sister Carlin, you in the banking industry, the financial institution thing, what do they tell you? They give you a choice. Do you want to take an inflation beater? Any of you heard of that? When you take an investment or a pension or a policy, they ask you, do you want an inflation beater? What's an inflation beater? One, you know what they do? They kind of work with statistical formulas that kind of give them an indication of what things will look like in the future. It's like many, you know, they had this picture of what would happen. And then what happened in 2019, COVID happened. And what happened? All these predictions they made, you started seeing people losing money on their investments, on their pensions. Things just started going haywire. You understand what I'm saying? I mean, I look at us at work. You know, steel prices were so, the steel market was really difficult. And then when COVID happened, all of a sudden things started to shift. Now, the market has thrived. I mean, you all know, you read it in the paper. I mean, Mittal, South Africa, 15, almost 20 years ago, the last time they ever showed a prophet. And then, post-COVID, they're making prophets. I mean, you see that with lots of industries. You see now, they give you all these inflation beaters. It still doesn't work. But here's a more sure way of beating inflation. It's called the Word of God. You grow faster than inflation. You grow faster than the enemy. Listen, the enemy will come with strategies, but you'll be so advanced and so high up and so far, it will not be able to catch up with you. Talk to me, somebody. Hallelujah. Point number six, it doesn't matter what your situation looks like. Align yourself to what the Word of God says. Align yourself. Come in perfect alignment. I mean, it's a pleasure driving a vehicle that has just had wheel alignment. You know that? You know, you drive a vehicle and it last went for alignment and balancing centuries ago, feels like that. And you drive it, and you just let go of the steering. That car's either going off the road or it's going into the next car that's coming this way. But when the alignment is done, you can just do this. You can't just go. Same with your life. It doesn't matter what's happening. Keep yourself in alignment with the Word of God. Amen? Number seven, hold on to the Word. If you hold on to the Word, you will never fail. I'm here to tell you, you will never fail. I'm here to tell you this morning, your dreams will come to pass. They will not fail. Pursue your dreams. I said, pursue your dreams. Amen. You may say, Pastor, you know, when I was a child, this was my dream. Yes, maybe now you think it's too late and get another dream. You can always change the dream. This is your life. You want to change the scenery? Change the dream. Because the dream that you didn't achieve when you were a child brought you to a place where you started with a failure mentality. I didn't make it. No, it's not too late with God. It's never too late with God. Remember that. It's never too late with God. Hold on to the Word. You will not sink. You float. I said you float. Lastly, the study of the Word of God will keep shame and disgrace far away from you. Study the Word. The Word will not cause you to be ashamed, will not cause you to be disgraced. Instead, the Word of God will cause grace to come towards you. The Word of God will cause wisdom to come towards you. You'll get wisdom, you'll get understanding, you'll get counsel, you'll get everything by the Word of God. And as you do so, you'll find, you'll get ideas. You'll be sitting in meetings. You'll be sitting in a meeting, Sister Denise, Sister Alicia, you'll be sitting in a meeting, Sister Jason. The people are saying, listen, we've got a problem. We don't know what to do. And you see the Word of God. It's loaded with resources, Sister Trish. It's loaded with resources. It will bring knowledge and wisdom to the forefront. That you'll speak that word in that season. You'll speak a solution into that problem. They present the problem, you present the solution. And you know what will happen? They'll recognize you. Remember, I told you last week about Joseph. I told you about Joseph. Look at Daniel. Look at Shadrach, Meshach, Abednego. There was something about them. People recognized that there was wisdom in these young men. They recognized that there's something unique about them. That's why many of you sit in meetings and you do what everybody else does. They keep quiet, you keep quiet. They don't ask questions, you don't ask questions. The only stupid question that you ever ask is the one you never ask. Never be scared to ask questions. It's people who question who grow in knowledge. It's people who question who grow in wisdom and in understanding. So when you get to a meeting next time, and the others are keeping, remember, I just shared with you, we don't do things because everybody else is doing. Well, everybody's keeping quiet, I'm going to keep quiet. No. Make your voice heard. Bring it to the table. Ask the Holy Spirit, Lord, guide me. Holy Spirit, give me the words that I must speak. And the Bible tells you that him who lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally. As you ask God for wisdom, God will give you wisdom. And you bring something to that table. Everybody else is quiet. They won't look at you. And even when they look at you, you may find you open your mouth once. And now you're always opening your mouth. And they look at you like you say, you've got a big mouth, eh? I've got a big mouth because I've got a big God. You see, when I talk, I'm roaring. You see, the others are meow. They can meow all they want to. I'm going to roar. You with me? Speak. Because you know what? Jesus. God says, I'll bring you before men of great stature. He brought Joseph before Pharaoh. He brought Moses before Pharaoh. He brought Daniel before the king. He brought Mordecai before the king. I see God bringing you before somebody great. Can you talk to me, somebody? Because when God does that, that's your moment, that's your season, that is your time. Come on, talk to me. Because when you're there, you're not ashamed, you're not afraid. Come on. Jesus said, you'll come before men of great stature, and you will not need to think of what, come on, it will be given to you in that hour what you ought to speak. And as you speak, the person that is hearing that will hear words. Listen, the words you speak are seasoned with grace. God will give you grace in the eyes of the hearer, that when they hear you, they say, my God, this is the person that I need in my section. This is the person I need in my company. Are you hearing me, somebody? Oh, glory to God. You don't know which person is sitting there. But as they hear him, they say, my God, where does this wisdom come from? Where does this intelligence come from? It is not artificial intelligence. It is divine intelligence. As you speak, you'll find very soon the same person that was hearing you will one day pick up the phone. Listen, how are you? Are you interested in the job? I've got a position. Are you hearing me, somebody? Are you hearing me, somebody? Come on, Alicia, are you hearing me? Carl, are you hearing me? Trisha, are you hearing me? Nero, are you hearing me, somebody? Kenneth, are you hearing me? Come on, Dolly. Hallelujah. Laubo Shiendo Koromande Pramatia Sakata. See, last week God gave a word about remembrance. God gave a word about remembrance, and this day, this week, He's giving another word about remembrance. People that have forgotten about you will remember. Come and talk to you, they'll remember. People that rejected you will start celebrating you. Oh, Jesus. Come on, somebody. Unexpected faith. Unexpected income. Unexpected breakthrough. Unexpected increase. Unexpected promotion. Unexpected. Unexpected. I've got a position. Are you interested? Of course I'm interested. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Word of God will keep you far from shame and disgrace. Come and let us stand. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for your word. Thank you, Jesus. Because of your word, Lord, we are not going under, we are going up and over. There's only one way, it's up and over.
Of God. We thank you, Lord.
love of God and the sweet fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and abide in each and every one of them, both now and forever.